Well, good evening. Welcome to the house of God. I greet you in the name that's above every name, that name of Jesus Christ. What an awesome name it is. I'm thankful tonight, and I'm so glad that I'm saved. I'm so glad that I belong to Him. I'm so glad tonight that we're going to talk tonight about an unseen place of refuge. I thank God there is a place of refuge. Amen. What an awesome thing that is to know that everything's going to be all right. That at the end of the day, no matter how bad it gets, no matter how bad it seems, no matter what kind of shape the world's in all around me, to know that there's a place of refuge and to know that I'm right in the middle of it, to know that God's hand of favor is upon me. That's one of the greatest things I've ever known in all of my life. I've lived with it and I've lived without it. And I can tell you this, that when God's hand's on something, you can't mistake it. He showed me a long time ago, He told me that everything growed, even kudzu and briars and stuff like that grows. But He said, if you look close, you can tell what God's got His hand on. It'll always bloom. Even in death, it'll have some kind of a bloom to it. Even when it's passing from this life going to the next one, and things seem that they ought to be bad, it'll still have a bloom to it to some degree. Anything God's got His hand on. I appreciate that tonight. And I thank God for the unseen place, and I thank God for the unseen hand that's been on us. No telling what God's kept us from. No telling just how much evil He's kept us from. No telling how much of the enemy God's really kept us from and shielded us from. You know, today I was praying. I was on the way to work this morning. I had a moment. I got caught up with the Lord and just had some time with my Father. And I caught myself and I was praying. I said, God, let me see what I need to see. And I said, whatever I don't need to see, I don't want to see it. I said, I trust You with all my heart. Amen. That's what I want to see, what He wants me to see. And all day long, I'll tell you what He showed me is a harvest. That's where His mind's at. That's what God's concerned about, is that harvest out there. There's so many people that can't see this unseen place of refuge. So tonight, when we pray, I want us to capitalize on something. I want you to think in your minds, in your hearts tonight when we pray. I want you to think about somebody in your family, somebody close. Maybe God's put them on. You know the difference when God's highlighted somebody to you and somebody that needs prayer, somebody that's lost, that don't know Jesus, because that's what it's going to come down to, is saved or lost. You know, I thought today again about that majestic ocean liner. You've seen so much about it. They said it wouldn't ever sink, the Titanic. You know, when that thing set sail, do you understand in that ship they divided, had three categories of people. It had the upper class, lower class, and the middle class. That's the way it was. But over in the Cunard offices in New York City, when they were looking for survivors, they only had two lists. One was lost, the other was found. That's what it's going to boil down to. God's going to divide it right down the middle at the end of this thing, lost or found. Me and you may divide it middle, upper, and lower, but I promise you God's going to divide it lost and found. That loved one you've got, they're either lost or they're found. They're on a narrow road or they're on a broad road that's leading to hell. And it's up to you and I to present the gospel to them. It's up to you and I. Don't let anybody in your family, listen to me, do not let anybody in your family go to hell without you preaching the gospel to them. Amen. Without you praying for them. Without you doing everything you know to do to pull them out of the fire. This is serious stuff right here. You and I have a chance. I've got some new guys working for me and they're young. And for the first time in my life, I'm seeing something. I'm seeing this. I'm understanding that I have a small opportunity to take a young guy that doesn't know anything and teach him how to get his mind in gear and teach him and give him a hand up and help him how to learn to get his mind on things to grow up to be a man. We've got the same thing in the kingdom of God. We have an opportunity to reach out and get a hold of somebody by prayer. That's the whole business of this thing here. You know, it'd be a shame if we come to church and shout and had a good time and went home and kept Jesus all to ourselves. Jesus was a soul winner. Me and you need to be a soul winner. He that winneth souls is wise. I want to be wise. I wonder what's going to happen when you and I stand before God on the day of judgment and He looks at that investment that He put in our lives whenever He saved us and asks us what we've done with it. I wonder how much time you and I really spend preaching the gospel on a day-to-day basis. I wonder how much time we really spend praying for the lost and praying for those that are without. I wonder how much of a difference you and I could make in our families, in our home lives, people around us, on our work job, on the job, if we just preach the gospel to them. I don't mean stand up beating a drum. I mean live this thing in front of them. I mean pray for them earnestly. I mean Be whatever profession you are, be that, but be a disguised prayer warrior. You're looking for souls. You're looking for somebody to pull them out of the fire. You don't have to look far for that, my friends. They are everywhere. I promise you, they're everywhere. The scripture bears this out. Jesus said it was plenteous. He said, pray that the Lord of the harvest send forth laborers. He's looking for laborers tonight. That's what he's looking for. Somebody that'll sign up and get in this kingdom and work this ground. By the way of prayer tonight, I want you to think about this. I want you to think about this kingdom like a garden for just a moment. And we've spoke this several times here, but it's a really great illustration. It really gets your mind in gear. If every one of us down here on this earth, say if we had a garden, it was, 10 miles or whatever the case, whatever the dimensions, and we just give everybody a 5x5 piece of ground. If you just mind your business and work that 5x5 piece of ground, I wonder what kind of a garden we'd have overall when we left here. If we'd just find out what God's told us to do and mind our business right there in that 5x5 and work it and work that ground, what are we doing to the ground God's gave us? What are we doing? Because where you're working, I believe it's providence. I believe God knew exactly what street I was going to be living on whenever I got to this point in my life. And so the question is tonight, by the way of prayer, am I winning souls? Is my mind in gear? Am I thinking about winning souls? Am I looking for the lost? Am I looking for an opportunity to witness? I'm not talking about beating them to death or slapping them with a Bible. I mean, maybe speak one word in season. Sometimes one word can turn everything. This Bible even says a soft answer, turn away wrath. Think about that. One word anointed by the Holy Ghost of God, when God's in it, it'll be more than any amount of sermons or books that ever was written or preached. I want us to think seriously tonight about souls. I want us to think, God told me not too long ago, He said there was enough people than just a few miles of this church that if we could reach them, said He'd fill this thing up and run it over. We couldn't hold them, just in a few miles. I wonder what happened if we just work our ground, what God's given us. I want us to think about that by the way of prayer tonight. Also, I heard from Mike Penland this morning. I hope he's watching tonight. I hope they got his, he was pretty upset that he didn't get to come to church tonight. I guarantee you that was on his list of things to do today, and he's probably more upset about that than he is anything. But he came through his operation okay. They weren't able to save the kidney. They did have to take the kidney. The doctor didn't feel like he's got it all, so they took it. But I got Mike, if you're listening, somebody in church testified right before the church and said they had the same thing, what was it, Mark, 4 years ago? He had the same thing 4 years ago, and they took his kidney, and he said he's been percolating just fine. He said everything's all right, so be encouraged. So we want to pray for Mike tonight and lift him up. I want you to remember, too, all the ones that's rolled in, all the ones that's sending messages. I want to stand with them in faith. Remember them. Let's pray. And let's pray God makes soul winners out of them and save their families. I want to go to heaven and take as many with me, don't you? I don't want to get to the end of this thing and look back and say, Lord, I missed it. I want to get it right now. Now's the time. Right now we can do something about it. It'll be too late when the trumpet sounds. There's going to come a time it's going to be dark and a man can't work. I want to work while I got some light. Amen. I want to make a difference. Well, that said, we want to start on this side in the front. Prayer request.
Okay. It'll be a solid month. He's had kidney stones and having to wait because of all the protocol that they've got to go through and everything just to get him in for surgery. So just please remember him.
Yeah, remember this. Remember this. Yes. Marlon? Amen. Remember this. Pray for Jessica. Anything else over here? Prayer request. Chris, I'm getting an echo. Is these on? The red one? The red one on the lapel? If it is, turn these all the way off for me. Anything on this side? Yes. Remember this. Okay. Yes. Remember this. Anybody else? Prayer request. Remember Corey's brother. All right. Millie?
I've got my friends, neighbors, who prayed for years.
Yeah.
He's going to give us
believe that. Yes, Millie. Okay. Remember this. We believe him for two or three to quit smoking, right?
Yes.
Amen. Anybody else? Is your volume okay, Chris? Okay. Just had a bad echo. Anybody else? Prayer request. Remember the lost. Let's remember every request tonight. Now listen, me and you are fixing to get in some, we're fixing to get into the supernatural waters with this business of prayer. I mean, right now, I want you to think about this. I remember some time back, now this, remember this in testimony by the way of prayer. Some time back, I had a vision of the Oval Office, and I was sitting in it, and the president was looking at me, and he was expecting me to pray over a decision that he had to make. And I come to, and I thought, Lord, where are you fixing to send me? And the Holy Ghost dealt with me. He said, that's the Spirit. He said, you can pray right where you're at. That there's no limitations when you're praying in the Holy Ghost. You see what I mean? If God's put somebody on your heart, it's there for a reason. Pray for them right then. Pray. You can touch the world by prayer. It's the very ground that the supernatural things begin to happen. It's the very place that miracles begin to happen. Amen. There's been mighty mountains that have been moved by this business of prayer that we're about to enter into. I want you to think about the lost in your family, connected to you, in your home, your neighbors, people you work with, and I want you to just single them out in your heart and pray for them and lift them up to God, and let's believe God for this harvest out here. There's enough people right here. Could you imagine if 50 people connected to this church got radically saved? I mean, fell in love with Jesus. The power of God hit them. Conviction hit them. The Holy Ghost saved them and turned their life around. Could you imagine the kind of revival we'd have? I'm talking about a real revival. I'm talking about a revival of a harvest of souls. Amen. You see, let's me and you get to work. Let's me and you be tenacious with our prayer life. Anything else before we pray? Amen. I want to tell you something, businessmen. Me and you are going to be in trouble when we stand before God if we're not careful. I'm one of them. Me and you got an opportunity that some people don't have. We have an opportunity as working people. We have an opportunity to work with them. We have an opportunity that some people don't have to pray for them and to work and help them pull them up, teach them to get their mind in gear, bring them, help them get a hold of their own bootstraps and pull themselves up. Amen. Teach them how to rely on the Lord. Me and you in a good place. Some of us in leadership positions on the job. Some of you, I think Mark's going into one there. He's got an opportunity. I mean, I believe the Lord's repositioning some of us and put us here for a reason. I'm going to tell you this and we're going to pray. I walked across my living room and I reached and grabbed the light switch. And I remember right where I was at and God told me. He said, I never called you according to where you were back 20 years ago. I never called you according to that. He said, I called you according to where you are today. And I realized God had placed me in this same way with every one of our lives. God's placed us there for a reason. And the question is what are we doing with it? But right now we can change it if it's not what it ought to be. Right now you've got an opportunity. Right now you and I can win souls, amen, and be wise. Anything else? Dear Heavenly Father, we call on your holy and righteous name tonight. God, we love you and we thank you for your grace. God, we thank you for your mercy. Father, I thank you tonight, God, for the blood of Jesus Christ. I thank you, God, for this new covenant. I thank you for salvation, Father. I thank you, Father, for everything that you've done. Tonight, we praise you, God, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you so much for everything you've done for us. God, there's so much that we can't even see, God, and we're unworthy, Father. I thank you for that you made us worthy by the blood of Jesus Christ. Father, I thank you, God, for the soul winners that prayed for us, God. I pray for all the ones, Father, that's still with us, that's paved this way, that's had a hand in the work that we're a part of today. God, we pray that you bless them, God. I pray that you touch them. Father, we couldn't do what we're doing if they hadn't did what they did and hadn't stayed the course. And God, we're thankful for them, Father, and we realize we're a team, God. There's no big I's or little U's here. We realize tonight, God, that we're all working together and pulling for the same cause, Father. I pray that you'll touch everybody connected with this kingdom. Father, I pray that you'll touch them tonight in the name of Jesus in a supernatural way, God, that we'd be soul winners, God, wherever we may be, God, that we may witness this light of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we love you and we need you, God. And tonight we bow our heads to you, God, and we give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor in your house. Father, I'm asking you tonight, Father, on the behalf of this whole church, for everyone that's rode in, every special request, Father, I pray that you touch every one of them, God, in a magnificent and powerful way as only you could do. God, tonight we stand with them in faith, God. I'm asking you to touch them, Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray for every lost soul that's connected to this ministry in any way, God, whether it be by marriage, God, whether it be by family, whether it be by heart, or whether it be by mind. Tonight, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask you to touch every one of them, and I pray you'll touch them, God. Change their heart, transform their lives, God. I pray that conviction would hit them. God, we pray that tonight, God, we want to be serious about this. God, we pray that they won't even be able to sleep, God, that they'll turn to you, God, before morning. God, I ask you that you'll save the lost, God, from the uttermost tonight. In the name of Jesus, God, I pray that the saving power of Jesus Christ and the knowledge of Him, God, flow throughout this land. God, let there be a revival birth started tonight, God. Let there be a revival of souls, God, won into the kingdom of God, swept into it, God, by the thousands. Father, we pray tonight for everyone in the church, God, every request that was mentioned here already. I pray for every one of them individually. I ask you to touch them, God. I pray you touch every family member, touch every need, Father, according to your riches and according to your glory. Father, we pray tonight in the name of Jesus, God, that you'll touch everyone connected to this church, God. Maybe there's somebody lost. You see the hearts of your people sitting here tonight, Father, and we come as humble as we know how and lay those at your feet, Father, and we ask you, God, to touch our loved ones, touch our lost ones around us, Father. We pray that you'll touch the babies, God. Touch the children. Pray that we lose not a one, Father. We ask you tonight in the name of Jesus, you'll touch them, God. Put a shield of protection around them all the days of their life, God. We pray for our children, God. We pray, God. We get ahead, Father. We ask you, we get ahead of this thing, Father. Them growing up, and we're asking you tonight that you'll give us wisdom, Father, and give us understanding, strength, courage, and guidance and wisdom to bring them up in the fear and the admonition of the Lord, Father. I pray tonight, God, you'd help us to take a stand that hell and Satan couldn't have them in Jesus' name, God. In spite of the naysayers, I pray, God, that you'd give us the power, God, to walk as we need to walk before our children and before our families, God, that we'd be the king and priest of our household, God, that it'd be in order, God, that you'd bless it. Father, I pray that you'll help us to preach this gospel in everything that we do, God, even when we sleep, God. Let us glorify you. Father, we ask you tonight in the name of Jesus, Father, a special need tonight, Father, that rings in my mind, in my heart, one that's been heavy on my heart. I pray, God, for the dads out there, Father, and the one in particular. I pray that you touch him, God, before it's too late, Father. I pray for the families, God, the ones that are in tatters tonight, the one that seem to be in shambles, God, that's been wrecked, Father, by bad decisions and wrecked by bad parenthood. Father, tonight, in the name of Jesus, Father, we pray that you'll cancel the harvest, the seeds the enemy has sown, God. I pray, Father, is you the only one I know that can unscramble an egg. Father, tonight in Jesus' name, we pray that you touch every situation. God, we pray that you show up, God, and we pray that you stand and be glorified in every situation, God, and we give you the praise. We give you the glory tonight, Father. We give you all the honor, God. We love you, Father. We love you with all of our heart, God. We want to love you more, Father. We just don't know how. Help us, God, to be faithful to you to the end, to stand at our post of duty, Father. I pray each one of us, God, individually and collectively, God, we pray that your will be done, that you'll touch us, God, that we'd be laborers, God, into this harvest. I pray, Father, you'll help us, Father, as us that's working men. I pray that you'll help us to touch them, God, and bring them closer to you, Father. Let us do everything that we do, God, to please you. I pray, help us, God, reform, reshape, remold our minds, our hearts, our wills, and our ways, God, to please you and you only, Father. And we love you and we appreciate you so much, God. Thank you, God. What an honor it is to serve you, Father, in the time that we live. We give you praise. We give you glory one more time, for it's all in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. I want to talk about the unseen place of refuge. You know, I've said this so many times from the church, this church and other places that I've ministered, that one of the greatest tragedies, you know, I picked it up some years ago from another minister, but it was so true in what he said. One of the greatest tragedies that ever has been is that somebody walked the streets of America last night or maybe tonight, and the Lord Jesus Christ lived on the inside of them and nobody ever saw it. And I just wonder how we're conducting ourselves every day. And I wonder, are we bearing in mind that as we walk through the life that we live, that somebody's standing next to us, and in many cases, maybe someone sleeping next to us every night, or whatever the case, or maybe someone in our house, maybe someone on our job, maybe someone we fish with, maybe someone we spend a lot of time with, they don't have the luxury of this unseen, this place of refuge. I want to tell you what happened to me, how I come to know this unseen place, and I've told this story 1,000 times, amen, but I still stand and preach it and tell it, and you ought to tell your testimony. If you don't tell your testimony, there'll come a time when you'll probably doubt the thing yourself. I'm talking about the testimony of Jesus Christ is the spirit of prophecy, and begin to testify of what Jesus Christ has done for you. Let me tell you something. When you begin to testify of what the Lord done for you, you've entered into a realm of prophecy according to Scriptures, and you're prophesying according to the Spirit, not according to the flesh, because when you begin to testify of how the Lord saved you and exactly what the Holy Ghost done, it's then, my friends, you've entered into a whole nother realm. You're talking, it's the Holy Ghost talking, because He's the one that done the saving. He's the one that done the wooing, and whatever work was done, is done, and will be done by the Holy Ghost of God, and it's a powerful thing for you to stand up and to tell your testimony. It's a powerful thing, and you know, as life goes on for me, the more I look and the more I pay attention, the more opportunities through my business and everything else that I do in this town, I find more and more of an opportunity to put in my testimony in some way. I can't tell you, in the last week alone, when I've talked about how blessed we've been, somebody wants to know, am I advertising? That's been asked to me several times, and it's been the same thing every time. I said, no, I've done nothing. It's just the hand of God. It's just the favor of God. And I can tell you how to get it. Get good and saved, amen. Get a hold of Jesus and let Him get a hold of you. And if He tells you to do something, bless God, just do it. Do whatever He says to do, amen. I'm telling you, there is a place of refuge like nothing I've ever seen before in all of this world. I'm talking about a place where you can stand, and I've done this. Me and my wife have done this. We have stood and watched our home burn down before our very eyes and lost everything that we have. Left there, went to Walmart, bought socks, toothpaste, underwear, had absolutely nothing. But I want to tell you what we had. We had a peace that surpassed all understanding. Why? Because I belong to Him. You see how I know this so well. I've not had that all of my life. There was a time that, friend, it would have bothered me. There's times that I didn't know what I was going to eat next week. I mean, I just didn't have a peace. Something was missing all of my life. And if I would have died, I'd have went straight to hell. And that's just the truth of it. But I'm talking about a refuge tonight, a place. And you and I that are living in luxury, so to speak, you see, I've got a place now on the inside that the banks, they can't repo it. I've got a place that can't nobody touch this. They can't nobody take this from me. This is something between me and the Lord. It's a relationship. And I can tell you, it gets sweeter all the time. And I would tonight that we could go and tell and preach and proclaim, amen, and tell, I wonder if we're really honest with ourselves when somebody comes with those eyes, those puppy dog eyes, and they're looking right through you almost, and they're wanting to know, how do you do it, or what do you do? I wonder what kind of stuff we tell them other than the Lord is good. It's good to belong to Him. I got no problem being God's kid, do you? I got no problem with Him being my daddy, amen. I got no problem anymore stopping, shutting down everything and said, let me tell you, amen, I'm blessed because my God is good, amen. I'm blessed because I belong to Him, and I'll be blessed, amen. If I lost everything that I had, I'd still have a peace that surpassed all understanding. And if it come down to to the death's door and I laid on the hospital bed about to breathe my last, I can still tell you God's still going to be just as good to me. Amen. Because I'll tell you why. Because in this refuge, let me tell you what else you get whenever you've got this place of peace and place of refuge. You also get another life. Amen. The real life. The real deal. A whole nother one. Amen. And you're not just focused on this one. So many people, if you look around you in the family, on the workforce, in town, go through the drive-thrus, and they seem that they just can't go any further. I can tell you what one of the biggest problems is. They've got a big saddle on their back, and it's called mostly the world, and the devil's riding that thing, and they're burdened down with the things of the world, caught up in suffering, and got their mind on a world that's going to pass away one day with a great noise. Amen. And they're not living the life and luxury of a peace of mind that surpasses all understanding, that knowing that my Heavenly Father, amen, when He looks up, guess what? He sees no one. And everything you can see and imagine is right in the palm of His hand, and everything is going to be all right. I've read the end of the book, and we win, bless God. And I wonder if we really understand, amen, what kind of a new covenant we've got with the Lord Jesus Christ and what it means to be in covenant with God. I can promise you God's not a covenant breaker, amen. Everything's going to be all right, but you look into the eyes of a man that understands that, or a woman that understands that, and everything is all right. But then again, you look out there, look at the drive-thru, amen. Look at the red lights beside you. Everybody's mad, and many of them, they don't understand a refuge. And I wonder what would happen if you and I took more time to look, if you and I took more time as we thought of the words of Jesus Christ, our Lord, whenever He said this. He said, this harvest, said, I tell you, it's plenteous, it's plenteous, it's plenteous. If we just look, you'd see how white they really are. You could drive through a drive-thru and see, amen. Sometimes the best gospel message you've ever preached was a good tip and a thank you, amen, and a smile on your face, praise God. Just be different, amen. There's been times and opportunities, and I'll tell you another one, praise God. Mike's probably watching. Me and Mike was sitting there one night. There was a gentleman come in. I've told this. I'll give you an example, amen. We were talking that night about soul winning when we left the church. We went down. We sat down at the Huddle House, and there was nobody in there but one gentleman. And he came over, and I just slid over and said, have a seat. I got to talking to him. How are things going? He said, not too good. And the Lord began to prod me just a little bit. And I asked him a question. I said, have you ever thought about dying? He said, yeah. He said, I do. And tears swelled up in his eyes. And me and Mike that night, we just prayed with him. Nothing special. I didn't try to counsel him. We just prayed with him that God would just come and work in his life. And I'm telling you, the next few months of that gentleman's life was on fire. He was a different individual. God was working. And I remember walking into the Huddle House a few days later. I said, is everything good? And boy, he'd smile and give me a big thumbs up. And it wasn't long after that, God began to bless him. He got a manager's position. And I want to tell you where he's at today. He's in heaven. Walking to work early one morning, a truck come over the hill and run over him, and it killed him. Now, I wonder what would have happened had someone not ministered to him. I wonder what would have happened. You see, that moment of agreement, amen, God began. If you'll just look everywhere you can look, the fields are white. And what are men you going to do about it? It's so easy to walk through this life and not do anything. It's so easy for you and I to read the scriptures like this. Go to Matthew, the 10th chapter, and I want to read you what's available to a whole world out there. What a terrible price Jesus paid for you and I. And what a tragedy it is for you and I. In Matthew, the 10th chapter, what a tragedy it is for you and I to walk around and this being on the inside of us and never share it with anybody. Never not once sit down and not stop pointing the finger and stop trying to correct and sit down and say, let me tell you something that'll change your whole life. Let me tell you something about witnessing that I've learned I'm making leaps and bounds with it on the job and abroad. If you'll understand, you take a man and you give him a fish, guess what he'll do? He'll eat for what? One day. He might eat for a day. But if you'll teach that man how to fish, he'll eat for a lifetime. If you can teach a man, let me tell you what the secret is. The secret is if you lack wisdom, ask him. Give him the gospel. Give him Jesus Christ. Whenever he's looking, fill the void. Say, Jesus will fill that. If you just ask God, you just give him Jesus. I learned something one day. I went to look at a job over there with a concrete guy. And he asked me, said, are you a pastor? And we were talking about ministry. And I said, yes, I am. And we got to talking about things. And everything everything that he said, he had an argument and he kept coming back to me. And the Lord kept telling me over and over and over in my spirit. I sat there with him. He almost wore me out, but I sat there with him for 2 hours. And as we began to talk, God would say, take him back to Jesus. And everything that he would say, I can't remember everything that was said, but everything that God would give me would take us right back to Jesus. And I finally watched him. He just slumped there and he looked at me and he said, it's Jesus. I said, you're exactly right. It's Jesus. He's the answer to everything. That's all he needed was a little recalibration. I wonder what would happen if you and I started living a life of Jesus, period. Just Jesus. That's the answer to everything. Instead of trying to fix everybody, tell them what will fix them, amen. Instead of trying to fix it and trying to clean them up, tell them who can clean them up, amen. Tell them, just try to get them to Jesus. I wonder if we had the mentality those men had, they went up and tore the roof off the thing and began lowering a guy down. I wonder, and those guys knew that I can't fix you. I can't do nothing. We can't do anything, but if we can just get you to him, everything is going to be all right. If I can just get my family to Jesus, if I can just get them babies back there of mine to Jesus and get them to understand that he is the answer, that he'll guide you in all truth. The Holy Ghost of God won't misguide you. He won't mislead you. If you'll pray and seek God's face and get a hold of him, they'll make it and everything will be fine. I wonder, amen, if we could. There's a scripture that a man put on his pulpit that said, sirs, and he was talking about a scripture over there where they came to see Jesus and they come to the disciples said, sirs, we would see Jesus. There's a man got that on his pulpit. When you get into it, he said, you look down as the first thing you see, he said, we would see Jesus. He said, you understand one thing when you get in my pulpit, they need to see him, not you. I wonder if we took that mentality, this harvest out here, and went into this harvest and say, how can I get this man to Jesus? Because in my own self-righteous way, and my mind goes to the ditch, and I think, how can I fix him? What does he need? I need to get him told. I need to put my finger in his face. Or do I need to sit here and talk about him and run him in the ground? Because that's just what the flesh will do. But I wonder what would happen if we truly said, how can I get this man to Jesus? How can I get him to Christ? Because that's what's going to fix it. That's what's going to turn his life around. If I can just get him plugged into the socket of Jesus, amen, everything will come alive, amen. He'll fend for himself, so to speak. If I can just get him to Jesus, if I can just take him to the food source, I can give him a little cookie. I can give him a little fish. I can maybe make him eat for a day. But my Lord and my God, if I could just take him to Jesus and teach him that's the way, he's the one that has the peace, it's passes all understanding. If I can just get him to him and the eyes ever come open, he'll be all right and he'll be looking for somebody else that he can take to Jesus, amen. And this thing will multiply is what I'm trying to tell you. There's enough people, the Lord told me, within a few miles of this church. I wonder how much evangelism you and I are doing. Evangelism, they talk about it being the middle finger. You know, when you're looking at the fivefold ministry, it's the longest reaching one. I believe in this fivefold ministry just as sure as I'm sitting here, but I see the spirit of every one of them working in that. There must be evangelism even in the pastoral, even in the preaching, the teaching. There's evangelism. It must be reaching continually, reaching in love and operating. Any one of them offices, I believe they all work together whenever God's there, when God and the Holy Ghost is working. I can see the spirit of every one of them working and reaching continually. I wonder what would happen if you and I got our minds focused on reaching the lost. Because I assure you this morning, this evening, that God is concerned about one thing, and that's the lost. He said that he would that none should perish, but that all would go to heaven. Amen. All that would make it. I promise you, God is very concerned. Amen. I promise you, God's weeping over souls and people going into the fires of hell, and God's very concerned about that. That's on his radar. It always has been. And I wonder, what are me and you going to do about it? I wonder how much praying we've done. Now, I don't want to beat you up too bad tonight because many of you are praying way more than I ever have. You've been in this way longer than me. But some of us, I wonder what would happen if we'd just do a little readjusting in our hearts, or a little readjusting in our minds, and ask ourselves, how can I get this man to Jesus? Let me tell you one of the most profound things I've ever seen in soul winning. Brother Harvey said this one day and it shook me. I ain't never got over this. Hope I never do. He said he got to praying one day. Went by the church. He's going to go out witnessing. Go talk to somebody. Said he went by the church up there and said, I got down and I prayed. Said, God, who you dealing with? See, God will burn the candle on both ends. God, who you dealing with? One of the most profound things there is in witnessing is this. Father, I need help. There's a man on my job or a man I'm working with, and God, I need to reach him, Father. I mean, grab a hold of the hem of the garment for that soul. Say, God, could you give me a word? Father, it don't even have to be me. Give a co-worker a word. Give somebody else a word. God, just save him. I don't have to be the one to do it. Just God, just get him to Jesus. Just get him saved. Amen. I wonder what would happen in our lives if we really got serious about it, because I can promise you one thing, and if this ain't true, I'll walk out the door and I'll quit. I promise you one thing, I have never found a time that I didn't get serious with God that He didn't get serious with me. I've never found a time that I didn't stop my truck and find me an oak tree. I've never found a time that I didn't go to the shop or go to a prayer closet and just sat down, amen, and every time it was just like God knew I was coming, if you understand what I mean. He was already there waiting on me. I've never found a time that when I meant business with God, I have never, ever, ever heard of a testimony in all of my preaching life. I've never heard of a testimony of anybody that really got serious with God and God turned them down for salvation. I've never seen any of that. I've never seen anybody that really got serious and meant business with God that He turned them down. I've never seen not one of them. I've never heard a testimony that said, I wished I hadn't got saved. Wish I'd have never done this. I've never heard that before in all of my life. I've never seen a time. I wonder what would happen if we truly got serious about the souls that are around us. I wonder, you know, we worry about outreach, but I wonder about just the outreach in our families. I wonder about the outreach in our household. My goodness, if we can't win them, my Lord and my God, if we can't reach and grab a hold of the hem of the garment for somebody else right there in our own neighborhood, right there in our own household, we'll never reach anybody beyond that. What a powerful thing I'm talking about tonight. I'm talking about the difference between life or death. I told you the story that just broke me. I mean, I still can't get over it. My aunt grabbed me over there. I left the church one day. I went over there to Old Country Church to pray. We were getting ready to leave, shaking hands, and she'd come to me. She'd come to listen to me preach. I'd live beside her up until I was 15 years old until we moved to Clayton. And before Dad built the house, we had a trailer right beside theirs. And she said I was in diapers, said I hadn't been walking long, and back then we just run all over the place. She said she'd come to me after church one night. Listen, come to me after church one night and grab me and just weeping. And she said, I want to tell you something. I said, nobody ever knew, but said, you used to run through my house. And she said, I would reach and grab a hold of you, and I would pray and beg God to take you and use you. And she just wept, and she said, and look, said, God's using you. And I just wept. I couldn't believe that somebody took time to pray for me, and look, it caught up with me, is what I'm trying to tell you. I wonder what happened if you and I would sow some seeds. I wonder what would happen if you and I, instead of maybe praying for myself all the time and asking God to give me the winning lottery number, if we'd go somewhere and say, Lord, I pray for John in the name of Jesus. Lord, if he don't have you, let's be honest, he's going to die and go to hell. God, I'm begging you, save his soul, because I promise you that'll fix everything if you can just get him born again. If you just get him to Jesus, it'll fix everything. Those of you that have children that's wayward, you just get them to Jesus, he'll fix them every time. You can't clean that thing up before you catch it. I can promise you that. Don't stand in the way of a sinner. Bring them to Jesus and let him clean them up, and he'll fix everything. It'll be made whole, and they'll change their whole life, change their whole outlook. We saw it even in the lighthouse down there. You've seen the ones that come through, the ones that get it, the ones that don't, but the ones that get it, they're radically changed. Something happens to them, and I'll tell you, one of the greatest evidences is when they get good and changed, and they change their life, they're working to change other people's lives, amen. Their own call, and working with other people and ministering to them, and you know what they're doing, in essence, if you listen to their testimonies, they're doing everything that they can to get other people to Jesus. That's what it's all about, is just get them to Jesus. Get them to Jesus. I want to tell this again. I've told this a lot, but maybe this will help us tonight. By the way of soul winning, I feel the Holy Ghost in this. By the way of soul winning, I'm thinking so fast I can't even talk. Go down to Pizza Hut, order a cheese pizza. They come out and say, I'm going to show you a video of how we made our cheese, 30 minutes long. Then they're going to bring another video, and they're going to say, I'm going to show you in 30 minutes, a 30-minute video on how we made our pepperonis. You're going to get up and leave. You know why? Because you went there for pizza, not to watch videos. You can't, nothing else is going to work but Jesus. The only thing is going to win this thing. The only thing that's going to work is Jesus. The answer is what? Jesus. Say it again. Jesus. That's the answer. Jesus. Not pizza, not pepperonis. Jesus. That's all that'll work. It'll fix it every time. And that's what it needs to be about. That's what our minds need to be laced with. That's what our heart needs to bubble is Jesus. I need desperately, desperately to get my baby girls and my baby boy. I desperately need to get them to Jesus. I need to tear the roof off the house and let them down in front of Him. Whatever it takes, I must get them to Jesus. I must point them and make my whole life's business about pointing them to Jesus, because that's all that's going to fix it. That's all that's going to help. That's the only thing that's going to, I can do and do and do, and it'll be nothing but a bunch of works. It'll be burned up, but I must get them to Jesus. I must pull them out of the fire. That's what the whole business is about. Every one of them, they came from miles around to get, if I could just get them to Jesus, if I could just touch the hem of the garment, that's the answer. It always has been. There's a great refuge there if you can just get them there, to the oasis, to the refuge. That same peace that I have now, I've had it so long that I'm ashamed I hadn't told no more people than what I have. I want to tell as many as I can. I want to tell as many as I can. I remember the poem Leonard Ravenhill said, oh, that touched my heart. It's getting more, it means more and more to me now. He said, some want to live within the sound of the church bell. He said, give me a shop within a yard of hell. He meant to find souls. He meant to go into the worst places and pray them out, pry them out, get them to Jesus. Whatever it took, get them to Jesus and get them one. You know what? We talk so much about Wigglesworth. We talk a lot about him. That name comes up a lot. And I guess so, my name would come up too if I'd rose the dead 12 times and it was documented. I guess my name would come up too. But I want to tell you what you don't know about Wigglesworth. One of his most favorite things to do, I've never been interested in what a man had to tell me. I want to know what somebody else said about the man. And so I went and found some books that a man wrote, that he led the man, or drove the man around for the last 8 years of his life, and he said this to Wigglesworth. He said he'd never seen nobody, said his passion, the one thing that drove him, was lost souls. Said one of his favorite things to do above all, and I'm talking about one of the most powerful men of God in that day. I mean, revival is still moving around his ministry that produced the work that God done, and is still reaching thousands today. And he never wrote a book. They took and wrote down in shorthand some of the messages that he preached, and they circulated those things, and people are saved and healed in many cases by just reading them. But Stormont said this of Wigglesworth, said one of his favorite things to do, said he would drive him down to, this tickled me, said he'd drive him down to a place over there overseas, and said they had a lot, when they got off the subway car, had a long flight of steps, had to walk up, and said just about they'd be out of breath, and said just about at the top of the steps, when you would level and your eyes with me, there was a bench sitting out there, and said Smith loved to sit on that bench, and said when somebody would get to the top of it, said he'd be sitting over looking at them eye level, and he'd say, are you ready to die? And they were out of breath. And Stormont said, you would not believe how many men and women that were marriages were split up. He said, I watched people walk up there, a man and a woman mad, walking up on both sides of the thing, didn't know Jesus, and said he would spend 30 minutes with them, maybe an hour witnessing to them, praying for them, giving them scripture, and they would leave with their arm around each other. And he said he sat right there and literally won hundreds to Jesus. That drove him. That was his passion. That's why he did what he did. That's why the God worked with him like he did, because he had the goods, amen. He was a soul winner at heart. A soul winner, that's what it was all about, was souls, pulling them out of the fire. That was his life's mission. Matthew 10. Matthew, the 10th chapter. Matthew 11. 28 says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You ever seen a plan like that? Wouldn't that do good? Go to Proverbs, the 3rd chapter. The Lord gave me this verse one time. On the first message I ever preached, listen, Proverbs 3, verse 5 says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. Would you agree with me that today a lot of people are troubled in their mind and troubled because they're leaning on the wrong understanding. And lean not unto their own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. And be not wise in thy own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. That's good preaching, ain't it? I mean, that's big stuff. Trust the Lord with all your heart, not some of it, but trust with all of it. I wonder, what are we doing to preach that? I wonder, what are we doing to teach that? I wonder, what are we doing to bring... They tell me that there's a certain type of battle carrier that crosses the ocean and says that it has its own energy field that they produce that stabilizes it on the water so that it doesn't move and they can land the stuff on it. I wonder how you and I are walking before a world out there that's lost. I wonder how you and I are walking before a world out there that the harvest is plenteous. People that need Jesus. I wonder, whenever they look at you and I, do we understand that we're under a magnifying glass? Do we understand that there's a whole lost world out there that's looking at us, and that we have a chance to minister and to walk and to talk and to take this scripture and go to them? I remember one thing about Brother Roy that got me every time I'd go. No matter what I asked him, every time I'd go and sit and talk with him, those hours I'd sit on that front porch, he'd always grab his Bible. No matter what I said, he'd say, well, let's see what the Word says. He'd always give me a scripture. And he said this. He said, always give the scripture. He said, load the gospel gun up with the scriptures. Pull the trigger. And he said, let the chips fall where they may. And he'd answer it with the Word of God. That served me well. I wonder, you and I, what are we doing to take them back to the Word of God? I wonder how easy it is whenever they ask a question, if we just know the Word of God and quote them, give them some scripture. If it's just a small piece of it. I wonder, is our minds geared by the way of missions? I wonder if our mind is geared toward looking for lost people. I wonder, do we understand these treasures? Trust the Lord with all your heart. I wonder what it's like if you and I could go and teach a man, to take a man by the hand. You know, you take a young boy, I know we've taught two of our little girls to walk, and you turn them loose, and what that's like to teach them to walk and to teach them to feel for themselves. And as they begin to grow up, you teach them how to get their mind in gear, and you teach them how to solve problems and stuff. I wonder, do we understand the joy it would be to grab a man or grab a woman that, I don't care what the age is, and they just don't know anything pertaining to the Lord, and we just take them that one scripture and say, look, I got something that'll fix it. I got something that'll make it all better. This Bible says, trust the Lord with all thine heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths. I'm talking about the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the man that literally spoke everything into existence. He promised that He would direct your path if I could just take you to Him, if I could just get you to Him. I wonder what a joy that would be like in our lives if we'd ever get one convert, if we'd ever get real, this one that was bad, I mean, one, pull him out of the mud, go and teach him, said, if you'd just get a hold of Jesus and to watch him do it, I wonder if it set us on fire and we'd be looking for another one. I wonder how many converts we've got in our lives. I wonder if the truth could be told tonight, how many people, answer this within your own selves, how many people have I led to Jesus? How many people have I watched and witnessed being pulled out of the muck, being pulled out of the mire? How much evangelism have I truly done? It gets close to home then when you go to thinking about that. How much time have I spent? You see, any good businessman will evaluate that profit and loss margin. He'll look where the holes are and he'll daub them up. Folks, it's about over. He said, Jesus told us in the Word of God, said to work while we have light. There's coming a day when no man can work. Right now, we have a little light left. Right now, we've got some time left. Right now, we have an awesome opportunity. Billy Graham said himself, he said, the greatest evangelism field in the world was the church. Think about that. People right next to us, looking for a way out. They need Jesus. Some of them are walking right next to us. Some of them are really close. And they're looking for the answer. And the answer is Jesus. Psalms 23. These are just some promises I want us to look at that you and I have in this new covenant. Psalms 23 says, the Lord is my shepherd. Thank God for that. I asked a man the other day, I said, you ready to go home? He said, well, he said, I'm going to wait. I said, no, I'm in your other home. He's an old man getting on up in his age up there at the store. And he said, he thought I was talking about going to his home up there on Wolf Fork. And I said, no, I'm talking about going home. And he stopped and looked at me, and tears run down his eyes. And he said this. He said, "The Lord is my shepherd." I never forgot that. He said, "The Lord is my shepherd." I wonder how many people out there need a shepherd. I wonder how many people out there need news, good news from a far country. I wonder if you and I got serious about it, how many people we could reach in the next couple of months. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. You know when I read that every time what the Lord stings me with? You can have the best steak that money can buy, paid for, sitting on a plate in front of you, cooked exactly like you like it. But if the Lord doesn't give you the appetite to enjoy that thing, it's worthless. It's worthless. Now think about that. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Sometimes, I want to tell you something, it gets heavy. Sometimes the steps, they get weary. Sometimes they get hard to make. Sometimes I wished it wasn't that way, but sometimes hell comes in like a flood and he goes to message, the devil messes with your mind. It makes it really hard to walk for Jesus for a few moments. But I can tell you about one tonight that can restore your soul. I can tell you about one just in a few moments can refresh and everything change. All of a sudden, he can make the worst circumstance that ever was look like a brand new deal. And that's my Jesus. And that's what the world needs, is Jesus. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. How many friends have you got that's about to walk through that valley of the shadow of death? You see, when you know him, that's all death is a mere shadow. A shadow of a dog can't bite you. Shadow of a truck can't run over you. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil with him. No. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. I'm talking about a refuge. I'm talking about an unseen refuge that nobody else can see. You can't see my relationship with the Lord. You may see the fruit of it, but you can't see what the relationship, amen. You can't, you know, the world out there can't see it. The Bible talks about if our gospel be hid, said it's hid whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds, lest the light of the glorious gospel should shine unto them. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Is your cup running over? Listen, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What a promise you and I have got in the Word of God. How many people around you don't have that promise? How many of your family members? How many people have you pulled to the side? Loved ones. I want you to judge what I'm about to say. How many loved ones have you gotten along with? They said, "I want to ask you something." Not beat them up. And ask them a serious question. Do you know the Lord? I mean, do you know if you're really, really saved? I don't want to beat you up, but I just want to know where you and the Lord stand. And if they say, "I don't know," ask them if you can pray with them. Start right there. Say, "Can I pray with you that God open up the Scriptures? God open up his heart. Open up your heart to him." And start. The journey of 1,000 miles. If you've never tried soul winning, the journey of 1,000 miles starts with a single footstep. You've got to start somewhere. Pull them to the side. Be courageous. Whatever it takes in your mind, just get it done. Folks are dying. They're going to hell. Ask the Lord. Don't leave the Lord alone. "Lord, what can I say? What can I say? Help me. Father, help me to be a soul winner. Help me to be wise. Help me to lead as many people to Jesus as I possibly can. God, give me the keys. Help me how to teach me how to fish. I love to fish. That's one of my greatest hobbies. And I've got more lures. I mean, and you can't take a crappy jig and catch a catfish with it most of the time. It takes a different bait. Every one of them's a little bit different. Find somebody in your family. Find somebody. Ask the Lord, show me somebody. God, highlight somebody. God, who can I pray with? Who can I witness to? Maybe I can take them a cake. Lord, what would you have me do? Let the Holy Ghost tell you. God can open up a door that no man can shut. And he can shut one that no man can open. I wonder what would happen if we really got serious. Jesus tells us, I got so many scriptures here, but Jesus said in Revelation 3:20, listen to this, right in the middle of that Laodicean church age, Jesus said in Revelation 3:20, he said, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice, open, and I'll come into him. I wonder how many people know that truth. I wonder how many people have known that there's a place you can go to. There's a refuge. I wonder how much of it we've proclaimed. I wonder how we could change the world, starting one person at a time. I said one time, I never forgot it. It came out while I was preaching, and a woman said it changed the way she viewed everything. I said, you're praying for the right person. I said, how about being the right person? I wonder how we could change just a little bit in our mindset about the lost, about people around us, people that are dying, going to hell, and they just need Jesus. Some people are just at the point of breaking. We prayed with a lady at Huddle House one night, and I had no idea. We were just getting ready to pray over our dinner, and the Lord just stirred me real hard that night. And I said, we're fixing to pray. I said, you got anything you want to pray about? And she just unloaded. She just unloaded and just wept while we prayed. Some people are hurting. Some people just need a kind word. That waitress, I don't know why I keep going back to waitresses. The Lord keeps bringing that back to me, but that waitress that you're mad at because your food's wrong, and it won't get to our own time, you don't know what she's going through. You might could be at the very moment, the very instance, and it could absolutely change the whole outcome of her life if we were just aware and not blinded by our own selfishness. If we were just aware that there's a whole harvest. Now, I'm going to give you this scripture in closing. Matthew, the 9th chapter. And I want you to take this scripture and I want you to put it in your shepherd's sack. And I want you to put it on your shoulders when you leave tonight. And I pray God burn it into your heart. Matthew, the 9th chapter. Now this is what Jesus said. Matthew, the 9th chapter. Pick it up in verse 35. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Can you see that today? Can you see it everywhere that you look? People, I mean, can you see that? Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous. It's plenteous. He says, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. We need laborers in the kingdom of God. Soul winners, prayer warriors that are willing to reach into the pits of hell and pull them out one by one. That'll pray them out of the fires of hell. That'll pray them out of the clutches of the enemy. That'll open their minds, open their hearts to Jesus Christ by this power of this glorious gospel. I wonder how many more days you and I are going to walk around with the knowledge of Jesus Christ in our heart. You know, you may have a friend that's real close to you at work, and you may not know the hell they've been going through in their mind. All they're needing is Jesus. All they're needing is someone to pick them up just for a few moments and total them just a few little steps over to Jesus and get them to him. It's a very solemn thought and a very serious thing tonight. We're going to close tonight in prayer for the lost. And I want you to think for just a few moments. And those of you at home, you think for a moment of those close to you in your family. Maybe you've got a husband. Maybe you've got a wife. Maybe you've got a child. Somebody that's lost. Tonight we're going to believe with you that God do the supernatural. We're going to believe with you the supernatural, that the Holy Ghost of God will touch their heart and touch their life. Tonight we'll enter into the supernatural one more time before we leave here? Can you think of anybody in your heart? Can you think of anybody in your mind? Dear Heavenly Father, we call upon your holy and righteous name tonight. Father, I pray and I ask you that you'll take this message, God, and write it upon the tables of our heart and write it upon our minds, God. And Father, I pray that you'll make soul winners out of us, God. I pray that you'll give us a brand new fishing rod tonight, Father. I pray that you'll touch us, God, by the power of Jesus. That you'll open our hearts, open our minds, God, that we'd win souls for you. Father, I pray that you'll make us mighty warriors by the way of soul winning. Father, I pray that you'll touch our hearts, open our minds, God, to your Scripture, open our minds to the Holy Ghost of God, that we discern, Father, when we're dealing with folks that are lost, that you'd help us, God, to bring them to Jesus. They would understand, Father. Help us, God, when we see them, Father, to understand, Father, that we can pray, God, that you may give us a word in season. Father, I pray you'll open our hearts to soul winning like we've never had it before. Gertha Ramey says, continue to pray for my son and family. Also, a homeless man named David. Father, in the name of Jesus tonight, we pray for David. I ask you to touch him, Father, in the name of Jesus. If he don't know you, Father, we pray tonight be the night, God, that you'll open his eyes to this glorious gospel. Father, we pray for her son in Jesus' name. Father, we've been praying for him for a while. And God, we ask you that you'll touch him tonight in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray you'll bring him home, God. Bring him back to the feet of Jesus tonight in Jesus' name. Father, I pray for everyone tonight, Father, that's watching, everyone that's here tonight that has a lost loved one. Tonight we bow our heads, Father, and we ask you to touch them in the name of Jesus. Father, we've come to the place tonight that we've stopped and we've surrendered before you. I pray the seriousness of this matter would reach our hearts tonight, that it'd find a lodging place. And that you help us to be more serious about winning souls than we've ever been. Father, tonight we pray for Daniel. I pray for that family tonight in Jesus' name. And God, we ask you that you'll touch him. I pray that you'll shake him to his core. God, whatever it takes, Father, we pray that you touch him, God. Turn his life around, Father. Touch his heart, God, and let it come back to Jesus where it's supposed to be. And I pray for that whole family. Father, you know the ones that are connected to this church tonight, Father. The families that are ravaged, God. The ones that have been affected by sin, Father. I pray that tonight, in the name of Jesus, that you'll touch them. I pray that they find their way back to Jesus. I pray that this great power of the grace of God touch them, God. I pray that you'll help us, God, to pry the roof off, whatever it takes, God, that you'll encourage us, Father, and show us the way to bring them to Jesus. Help us, God, to be a good steward of this name of Jesus when we go to work tomorrow. Father, I pray that you'll help us to understand just how serious of a matter this is, God. I pray, Father, tonight for all the lost throughout Clayton and around. We pray that you'll touch them, Father, in the name of Jesus. And we pray, God, that you'll sweep souls into the kingdom of God. Help us, God, to go forth the rest of this week and be soul winners for you. I pray that you'd help us, God. I pray we be tenacious in the name of Jesus before it's too late, that when we stand before you, we could hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Help us to be wise, Father. We give you all the praise and all the glory, for it's all in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Appreciate you watching. All hearts and minds clear.